If you have your copy of God's Word, open to John chapter 15. John chapter 15 is where we're going to be today. And we are in the fourth week of our series called Principles of Discipleship. Now, this series has kind of been one that one week has built upon the next. And so I kind of want to give you a 60-second recap of where we've been throughout this series. We started in week one talking about submission to the rabbi. And we learned that there is really no discipleship. There's no following Jesus Christ if we're not willing to yield and submit our lives to him. And then in week two, we talked about how we're to invest in relationships, not just relationships, but relationships with people that we can be transparent and where we can have accountability, and how God uses people in our lives to sharpen us and to grow us in the faith. Last week, we talked about some of the keystone habits, some things that we need to practically be doing in our lives, like being in God's Word, spending time with God through prayer, and serving the people that God has placed around us. And as we do those things, we see that God does a transformational work within our lives. Now, I told you that really to kind of set up today, because today's message is really kind of part B to last week's message. Last week, we talked about keystone habits. We talked about things that we should be doing. And today, we're going to talk about the thing that those things produce in our lives. In business, they call last week would be lead measures. Today would be the lag measures. The lead measures are things that you do as far as the inputs, and the lag measures are the things that are the outputs. And so today we're going to talk about kind of the outputs of what it looks like when we make the decision to follow Jesus Christ, submit ourselves to the rabbi, invest in relationship, and start to participate in these keystone habits. And Jesus tells us that there's something that is produced, and that something is called fruit. Turn to your neighbor and say fruit. Fruit, okay? That something is called fruit. Now, Jesus isn't talking about apples and oranges and bananas, okay? So what I want to do today, I want to answer, I see that banana, all right. What I want to do today, I want to talk about, I want to try to answer two questions from Scripture for us, all right? The first question is, what is fruit? Like, what are we talking about when Jesus says this word fruit? And the second question is, how do I produce fruit? Like, what does that look like in our life to actually produce fruit? So let's start with the first question, what is fruit? For a period of about 7 years, Aaron and I invested in a company, a publicly traded company. In fact, we invested thousands and thousands of dollars in this particular company, only to see all of that money go into the trash. Do I have you curious about what company it was? Pampers. We invested thousands of dollars in Pampers because we had three precious girls, right? And they need to have some diapers. And so I think we calculated at one time we were going through about 200 diapers per month. And some of you have babies and you know exactly what I'm talking about. If you see someone with a baby and God lays it on your heart to slip them a 20, man, that would be a huge blessing, all right? That's a lot of diapers, $20. So we were heavily invested in Pampers for a period of about 7 years. From the time Allie Mack was born till about the time that that Charlie kind of was potty trained, we were heavily invested in Pampers, specifically the company Pampers. Now, Aaron and I both liked the Pamper diaper for different reasons. She liked them because of the comfort and the protection that they offered our babies on the inside. That's what she cared about. That's, you know, the comfort and protection on the inside. You know why I like Pampers? Because there was something on the outside that was an indication that their change was happening on the inside. You know what I'm saying? So they had this little yellow line, right? It's a guy had to have invented that. That had to have been the invention of a man. Without this yellow line that would turn to blue when things heated up and warmed up, you would have to like take your finger and kind of poke and look and feel to see. It's nasty. You're making this face because like who would want to do that? So they invented this thing called this line, and it would change to blue, and that was the indicator that lets you know something took place on the inside, right? Now, you know, this is like, I've tried to think of other illustrations, not to be weird or nasty this morning, but I think that's the perfect illustration for what the word fruit is. You know what fruit is? Fruit is this. It is outside evidence of inward change. Outward evidence of inward change. When you produce fruit in your life, you are putting on display this outward evidence or something on the outside that other people can see that there was a change that happened in your life on the inside. Listen, when you're saved, you don't automatically grow hair. Like your body doesn't transform, but there is a very real transformation that happens on the inside. And you may wonder, like, well, how do we know that transition, like, how can we see? How can we tell if I'm a true follower of Jesus Christ? And here's what Jesus says. You'll know them by their fruits. You'll know that someone's a true follower of Jesus Christ, not by what they say or how they look or what they talk, but you'll know it by their fruit. You'll see it in the outward evidence that there has been an inward change. In John chapter 15, I want to read one verse real quickly, and then we're going to kind of circle back around and read the entire passage. Look with me at verse 8. Here's what Jesus says. He says, "My Father is glorified by this." Now pause and just kind of look at me real quick before we read on. What do you think Jesus would say next? Like if you were just reading this for the very first time, if you had no idea what was coming next, if Jesus said, "My Father gets glory from this," what would you think Jesus might say? You think he would say, "My Father gets glory when you lift your hands, when you get on your knees, when you worship him." That's true, but that's not what Jesus says. "My Father gets glory when you live a clean life." That's true, but that's not what Jesus says. "My Father gets glory when you go to church and you get in close proximity with other believers." That's not what he says. That's true, but that's not what he says. "My Father gets glory when you share the gospel with someone who is an unbeliever." That's true, but that's not what Jesus says. What did he say? "My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much," say the word with me, "fruit." Think about it. God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, our heavenly Father, he receives glory when you and I, as followers of Christ, bear or put on display fruit. So this is a big deal, all right? If you want to glorify God, one of the ways that we can do that, Jesus says, is by bearing fruit. And then he says this, "And so prove to be my disciples." How do we know that we're a true follower of Jesus Christ? Yes, there's submission. Yes, there's intentional investment in relationship. Yes, there's keystone habits. But Jesus said the evidence is in the fruit. The proof is in the fruit. So what is fruit? It is outward evidence of inward change. Now, I want to kind of talk specifically before we move on to the second question. What is, let's kind of stick on what is fruit for a second. We know it's outward evidence, but what specific evidence? Like, what is Jesus talking about when he says fruit? Now, here's the thing about the Bible. The Bible, if you didn't know, the Bible interprets itself, okay? It is a complete, authoritative word of God. So that means when you read a passage, you can look at other passages of Scripture to help you better understand that particular passage of Scripture. If you're with me, say, "I am." All right, so what we can do is, if we want to understand what Jesus is talking about when he says fruit, that you bear much fruit, we can look at another passage of Scripture to get a deeper, more clear understanding of what fruit is. Now, here's what Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 says. Now, this is written by Paul, but we've got to understand before we read it that Paul is writing this under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So what does that mean? It means that this is from God. This wasn't Paul's just ideas, you know, decades after Christ. This is Paul writing from God through the working of the Holy Spirit. He says this, "The fruit of the Spirit is," in other words, you don't have to guess what the fruit is when Jesus says, my Father is glorified in this, that you bear much fruit. We don't have to sit and wonder, well, what is he talking about? What is fruit? The Bible tells us, God tells us, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. So Jesus, let's kind of tie the two together. Jesus is saying, my Father is glorified in this, that you, as a follower of Jesus, bear much love. My Father is glorified in this, that you bear much joy. Did you know that as a follower of Christ, as a believer, as a Christian, when you live a joyful life, God gets glory, and you're living out proof that you're a follower of Jesus. And we can insert each one of these 9 characteristics. And I want to point this out to us because I think we have got to understand that there's a difference between fruit and good deeds. That Jesus isn't talking about good works when he says, my Father is glorified by this, that you do a lot of good deeds. Should we do good deeds? Yes. But there's something in between salvation and good deeds, and it's that character change. What do you think, as we display love, what do you think that produces in us? Love produces good works. As we start to live in the joy that we have in Christ and the freedom that we have in Christ, what do you think that produces in us? It produces good works. As we start to live a patient life, what do you think that produces? It produces works. In other words, when you're sitting in traffic, you don't just get frustrated and just get mad and start honking at everybody. No, there's a patience in there. That character trait will work itself out in your life. But we've got to understand that there's an in-between here. Between our salvation and good works, and that is the character qualities. It is the fruit that God wants to develop in your life. Now, what do? We tend to skip to the good works. Hey, just be a good person and just do this good stuff. Listen, that's exhausting. I cannot be a good person by my own strength. But as I follow Jesus, and as Jesus and God and the Holy Spirit, we're going to talk about that in a second, starts to produce fruit in my life, and I start to see some goodness and some faithfulness and some gentleness and some self-control, it's through that that I'm able to do good work. So what is fruit? It's outward evidence of inward change. And more specifically, he tells us it's the fruit of the Spirit. It's love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Now, you may be asking, okay, that's fruit, that's the stuff, I want that in my life. I think all of us would agree, I could use a little bit more patience. Anybody? Am I the only one? I think all of us could agree, you know what? I could use a little bit of self-control. Those Oreos. I think all of us could agree, I could use a little bit more kindness. So how do we do that? How do we do that? Well, Jesus tells us. In John chapter 15, let's read the first 5 verses. Jesus is talking to the disciples. He says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me, we'll come back to that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes it so that it may bear more fruit. You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Now, when Jesus says that, he's saying, look, I'm not talking about your salvation. You're already clean. You're already righteous. You've already been saved by the word because you've placed your faith in me. I'm not talking about your salvation. I'm talking about your sanctification. I'm talking about your holiness. I'm talking about producing fruit. I'm talking about the next step. In verse 4, he says, abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, so neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine and you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit. And then he makes this statement. He doesn't just stop there. He carries it a step further. He says, for apart from me, you can do nothing. We can't do anything of eternal significance. We can't do anything that truly lasts apart from Jesus Christ. So how do we produce fruit? I want to, really the way we answer that question is we've got to answer 3 other questions. As we answer those questions, I think Jesus gives us kind of 3 steps for how we can produce fruit in our life. The first thing is this, we've got to ask ourselves, am I abiding in Christ? You want to produce more fruit? Abide in Christ. Abide in him. He says, he who abides in me. Now, some of your versions, it might say, he who remains in me. Guess what abide means? It means remain. I'll just tell you in case you missed it. Abide means to remain. Now, if we were to kind of expand that definition, abide or remain means that you're constantly present. You're constantly present. Like right now, you are abiding in Carver Elementary School cafeteria. You're abiding. You are present. You are physically here. Your mind may be somewhere else, right? But your body, you are physically here. You are abiding. And the very moment that you leave, guess what? You've ceased to abide. You have stopped being present here as soon as you leave. And so Jesus says, look, I want you to abide in me. Now, I'm not sure if the disciples fully grasp this yet because Jesus is actually getting ready to leave. I mean, he's not with them for many more hours. He's getting ready to leave, but he says, look, I'm going to go, but I want you to remain in me. I want you to continue to be present in me even after I'm gone. Now, why do we need to be present in Christ? Why do we need to abide in Christ? Let's go back and look at verse 1. What does Jesus say? He says, I am the true vine. Why do you think he says true vine? Did someone call him a fake vine? And so he has to clarify, no, wait, I'm not the fake vine, I'm the true vine. Why does Jesus say, I am the true vine? Well, if you kind of know a little bit about the Old Testament and Israel, Israel was actually known as the vine. In fact, there's a psalm about it, a prophecy about it, that they would go inhabit the land and they would spread out. They would fill it like a vine. So Israel was known as the vine. That would have made sense to a lot of the Jewish people in that particular day. And so Jesus doesn't say, I'm the vine, you're the vine and I'm the vine, Israel's the vine and I'm the vine. He says, I am the true vine. Let's think about that for a second. How is Jesus the true vine? And for that, we've got to back up all the way back to Abraham. God tells Abraham, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to turn you into a nation. You're going to have so many descendants, it's going to be more numerous than the stars in the sky and the sand on the seashore. Abraham, I am going to bless you. And then he says, and through you, the entire world will be blessed. So it's not just for Abraham and his descendants. This blessing isn't just for Israel and the Jewish people only. It was for everybody. Why? How? Because one day through the Jewish people, through the nation of Israel, God would send a redeemer. God would send the Messiah who would die, who would take away the sins of the world. And then anybody who professed faith and trust in Jesus Christ could be saved. Their sins could be done away with, and they could receive the free gift of eternal life. And Jesus was the fulfillment of that prophecy. And so when Jesus comes in, he says, look, I am the true vine. What does a vine do? A vine is a conduit for life. It's where you get nutrients. It's what you feed off of. And Jesus says, look, your life isn't based on your connection to Israel. And I think for us, we've got to realize our spiritual life isn't connected to our church. The church is not the vine. Who's the vine? Jesus Christ is the vine. Now, don't hear me say that church is not important. That's not what I'm saying. But the true source of life, what I mean is you can come to church and you can miss out on spiritual life if you aren't connected to the true vine. So, if we're going to produce fruit, if those qualities, if those characteristics in our life are going to be on display for God's glory, for our good, we must be connected to the true vine. We have to abide in Christ. There's a second thing. We're going to spend a little bit of time on this one too. Second question we've got to ask is this. Am I allowing God to work? Am I allowing God? This is God the Father. We talked about God the Son, Jesus Christ. He's the vine, the true vine. We abide in him. But now we've got to look at God the Father. You know that God the Father wants to do a work in your life? Most of us, we want God to do a work through our life. God, use me, do this with me. But God wants to do a work in our life. So we've got to allow him to work in our life. Jesus says, I'm the vine, I'm the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. What's a vine dresser? Someone who tends to the vine, right? Someone who tends to the vine. Now, there's two things that that John tells us, or that Jesus tells us, that the vine dresser does. Verse 2, he says, every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. Now, this is kind of a challenging verse of scripture, and there's people that interpret this particular verse a couple of different ways. Let me just kind of give you my understanding of this. When Jesus, he says, I'm the vine dresser, Jesus says, every branch in me. He's not talking about unbelievers. He's talking about believers. Believers who are in me, they are connected to the vine, but they're not producing fruit. What is God going to do? Now, some of your versions, it might say he cuts off. The New American Standard says that he takes away. If you look at the actual wording, and some translations put it this way, it says that he lifts up. To take away means literally to lift up. So you think about a vine, the branches that produce the most fruit are the ones that are on top, the ones that are getting all the sunlight. So there's some branches down here, they're not getting any sunlight. So they're not producing any fruit. And we get this imagery here that God's just not going to chop them off and say, huh, you're done away with, you're no good. It says that he's going to lift them up. He's going to bring them into a position where they can receive what they need in order to produce fruit. In other words, God desires for you to produce fruit. Why? Because it brings him glory and it's for your good. So if you don't bear fruit, he lifts us up. If you do bear fruit, what does he do? He prunes it. Now, I'm no arborist. I'm no gardener. In fact, I remember one time when Erin and I first got married, her mother came over to our house and she looked at our flower bed, and I came home from work and she literally hacked off all of our flowers. I was like, you evil woman. It took us minutes to plant those and you just ruined them. I came back about 2 days later and what had happened? There was like three times as many flowers. She's way smarter than I am. She was doing the pruning process. We have a beautiful oak tree in our front yard, and a couple of months ago, we had an arborist come out and just kind of take a look at our tree. It looked fine to me. Looked healthy to me. It puts a lot of shade on our yard, puts a lot of shade on our house, and he comes by, and he immediately begins to identify all the branches and all the limbs that need to be trimmed. And he says, you know, here's a dead branch. I'm like, oh, yeah, I see that now. And he's like, oh, you got some mistletoe up here. That needs to go. He comes in with a crew, and they bring in like four chainsaws. And I'm peeking out the window, and I'm just seeing limbs just falling all over the yard. I'm starting to sweat a little bit. I'm like, I have no idea. This guy's going to kill our tree. And I just sit there, and I sweat, and I try to turn away. And then he gets done, and I go out, and, man, it's this beautiful tree. What was he doing? He was pruning. He was able to tell the things on the tree that were sucking life from the tree that I couldn't tell. But had it not gone through that pruning process, you know, it's just going to multiply years on down the road and it would just get that much more unhealthy. And so pruning is necessary. What does God do whenever we produce fruit? He prunes us. And what happens when we produce more fruit? He starts pruning again. He starts taking that chainsaw and he starts lopping off some bitterness. He starts lopping off some anger. He starts lopping off some areas that we feel out of control in our life. He starts lopping off some relationships that don't need to be there, some habits that don't need to be there. And he starts this pruning process. Why? So that we can bear more fruit for his glory and for our good. Now, we've got Jesus Christ in the picture. He's the vine. He's the one we have to remain in. We have God the Father in the picture. He's the one doing the work, the pruning in our life. And you may be wondering, well, what about the Holy Spirit? Where's the Holy Spirit's involvement in this whole producing fruit scenario? Well, if we look at what Jesus says, notice, he says, remain in me and what? And I in you. What does Jesus mean when he says, I and you? He's getting ready to leave. But he's telling the disciples, you remain in me and I will remain in you. I believe he's talking about the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will come and dwell within your life. As you remain in me and you allow the Father to work in you, there's a third thing we've got to do. We've got to yield ourselves to the Spirit. So the question we've got to ask is, am I yielding to the Spirit? Am I abiding in Christ? Am I allowing God to work? Am I yielding to the Spirit? Listen, as I was thinking about this message this week and this idea of producing fruit, and as I think about what Galatians 5:22 says, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. I don't know about you, but I feel lacking. Man, I just feel lacking. And so it's very easily to start questioning and saying, well, am I a follower of Jesus Christ? Because I'm sure not loving perfectly. I sure don't have perfect patience. I sure don't have perfect self-control. Does that mean I'm not a follower of Jesus Christ? Let me show you one more verse of scripture. This is from a guy by the name of Peter. And don't remember Peter? Peter's the one that said, Christ, I'll never deny you. And then he denied him. And then he went back to fishing. And Jesus had to call him back out of that. So here's this guy, as he grows, as he matures, here's what Peter says in 1 Peter 1:8. For if these qualities, or if these fruit, if these characteristics are yours, they belong to you and are increasing, they render you neither useless nor unfruitful. In other words, if these fruit in your life are increasing, God says, you're not useless. You're not unfruitful, which means we are useful and we are fruitful. Not when we're perfect in bearing fruit, but when we are increasingly bearing more and more fruit. As you think about the fruit of the Spirit, what's the one that you need to work on? What's the one that kind of jumps off the scripture at you and says, you know what, this is an area that needs some increasing. This is an area that needs some growing. Whichever one it is, that growth is going to happen when you ask God and you allow him to do some pruning in your life. So that's kind of where I want to lead us to today is, like, what's the thing in your life that God wants to prune, that God wants to take away? Now, taking that stuff away, it's hard and it's not easy, but oh, it's so worth it if we would bear more fruit. So let me kind of back up, because I don't want to miss this either. God is the only one that can produce fruit in our lives. We can't produce fruit. You can manufacture fake fruit, but as far as I'm aware, no person ever has been able to produce fruit. It's grown on a vine, on a tree. We can't produce it. God is the one that produces fruit in our lives. What are we called to do? Jesus says, my Father is glorified in this, that you bear much fruit, that you put on display much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples. Can we pray together? As we enter into a time of prayer, maybe God is speaking to your heart. He's identifying something in your life that needs to be pruned, something in your life that needs to go. And you might think, well, I don't want that to go. I've kind of got a tight grip on that. I'm not ready to release that yet. Would you just kind of remember just for a second that it is for his glory and it is for your good? That God doesn't prune to take away, to hurt, but he prunes to grow us so that we can produce more fruit, so that others can see on the outside there's been a very real change on the inside. Heavenly Father, we come to you today, God, recognizing that producing fruit is your work. As we remain in Christ, as we allow you, the vine dresser, to work in us and on us, God, as we yield ourselves to the Holy Spirit, your word says that our flesh desires what is in direct opposition to the Spirit, and Spirit desires what is in direct opposition to the flesh. God, today we surrender and we say we want to yield to you. God, and help us to bear fruit. Give us the strength we need to bear fruit, and may it be done for your honor, for your glory, and for our good, so that we can have confidence and proof and outward evidence, knowing that we're your child. God, thank you for giving us the opportunity to be your child. And it's in your Son's holy and precious name, the name of Jesus, that I pray. Amen.